Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning.
What a nice intimate gathering this is, huh? That's the first time we've ever had an announcement of me coming up, so I'm just going to repeat who I am, just in case you didn't hear it. I'm Jane McDonald, Executive Director of ONA, and I'm welcoming you here on behalf of our incredible board of directors and staff, our inspiring ONA15 gang of extraordinary volunteers, and our generous family of funder and sponsors. Welcome to LA. So, as you can tell by looking around this room, we've broken all records here today. First, we have well over 2,100 of our closest friends here today, ready to learn, network, and party. Oh, and excuse me, I just have to do this. I'm gonna take a selfie, if that's okay with everybody. First one ever. Seriously, let's just see if it works, because every time I try to do this, it never works. Smile! You have to smile, right? I got you all. You're all here. Okay, you can check that out at hashtag ONA15 in about 5 minutes. So we're joined today by over 1,000 first-time attendees. We just came from a breakfast and an orientation, and we hope that orientation is going to help you manage the next 3 days of programming and networking, which, by the way, includes 120 sessions, 9 workshops, 1 midway, new table talks, that's 115 tables simultaneously, 1 podcast contest, many karaoke battles, 33 OJA winners, and when in Rome, lots of film clips, and an advanced screening of a major motion picture coming soon to a screen near you. So that's what you have in store for yourself over the next 3 days. So we've established that this is a big conference with lots of new faces. Growth and change absolutely reflect what's happening in our industry. The way we gather information and distribute it is changing as I'm standing here. And the mark of our community is how you've weathered those changes together with excitement, hope, and the ability to move from meerkat to periscope in the blink of an eye. At each of our events and trainings, and in every class of scholars and fellows, we've seen firsthand the power of your connection to each other. It's what we built ONA on, and we've seen enough to know that these connections sustain you, motivating you not only to persevere, but to continue to reboot your craft. That's why we're delighted to announce a significant new grant from the Knight Foundation. $828,000 focused on using that power of connection to strengthen the vital work of local journalists across the United States. We'll use those funds to build on our ONA local program, which now has 50 self-organizing groups representing thousands of journalists around the globe who meet on a regular basis. We'll focus on cities and towns in the U.S. where journalists need deeper resources and training and tighter connections. Please join me in personally thanking Jennifer Preston, Knight's Vice President for Journalism, who knows ONA well from her days as a board member and cares deeply about ensuring community journalism is strong, fearless, and sustainable. And Jennifer, I don't know if you're here, but we're going to clap for you. Jennifer. We have lots of ways to get involved as an ONA local leader or member, and two are offered right here. Consider these the logical extensions of the amazing connections that we know you're going to make at this conference. We also know that there's no planning for the global, viral, and completely unpredictable nature of breaking news, whether they're on-air shootings, days of civil unrest born of racial and social inequities in our cities and towns, or masses of displaced families looking for a new home. The struggle to define new ethical boundaries in reporting is real, and it impacts nearly everything we do. To help, today we're launching the beta version of our Build Your Own Ethics Code. It's an online tool that gives you a menu of current best practices around 40 ethical issues that are unique to digital journalism. Using the tool, you'll be able to discuss, create, and customize step-by-step your own ethics code. And it's free to use thanks to a grant from the Ethics and Excellence in Journalism Foundation. And Sue Hale is down there. Thank you, Sue. It's fitting that we have the largest group of beta testers right here in this room, since this is a totally crowdsourced effort from day one, and it started at ONA 13. So please jump in today, try it out. There's an email for you to let us know your thoughts on the editorial content, and we'll do our best to sort through your feedback as we work toward phase two of the project. And make sure you join us today to talk ethics. There's a session on that. Our thanks go to our very patient and thoughtful news ethics editorial and design teams who have been working on this project for 2 years. One last announcement, this one about money we're happily giving away. Over the past 2 years, we've chosen 23 winning projects in our $1 million contest to encourage educators to hack the journalism curriculum. Today, we announce a grand prize winner for the Challenge Fund for Innovation in Journalism Education. Georgia News Lab and its partners will receive $65,000 for its innovative project, a series that led to a state ethics commission investigation into a program that squandered millions of dollars of federal HIV grant money. This was an incredibly impressive collaboration among four schools and two media companies in the state, none of whom had ever worked together before. So it's amazing work. We've also awarded $10,000 to the University of New Mexico for building its first news innovation lab run by students, the New Mexico Newsport, with 75 students and 7 partner organizations. This is exactly the high level of work we were hoping for when we launched the Challenge Fund. So please join me in congratulating these two schools for their professional work, as well as our remarkable collaborative and passionate cohort of funders, the Big Five: Democracy Fund, the Ethics and Excellence in Journalism Foundation, the Knight Foundation, the McCormick Foundation, and the Rita Allen Fish Foundation. Thank you all. Finally, it's election season, but no, not that one. Today, voting starts for the ONA Board of Directors, and you'll have a chance to meet all 11 candidates and hear their visions for ONA and digital news at a lightning round session later this afternoon. Be there, or you can tweet your questions at them at hashtag ONAElects. Then, ONA members, this helpful slide will get you to a virtual polling place. And so, I know you're all here for the keynote, but I know there's another reason why you're here. And that is, thanks to the MacArthur Foundation, we officially celebrate ONA 15 and you tonight with a very LA pool party right here at the Hyatt. Starts at 6 p.m. Don't be late. To lead you to our first keynote, I have the pleasure of introducing our board president. It's been an absolute privilege to work hand in hand with her over the past 2 years. She's been both an inspiration and a friend. Please welcome editor-in-chief of CNN Digital, Meredith Artley.
Thank you, Jane. I'm going to get back to you in a minute. I am so jazzed to be in Los Angeles. This is not just about Hollywood and movie stars and plastic surgery and traffic or all the other stereotypes that sometimes people lazily attach to this this city-state. This place is huge. It is one of the most creative and diverse places in the world, and I hope you get the chance to enjoy not just this fabulous, fabulous conference, but this wonderful, creative city. Jane, just take a look, everyone. She is, and meet her if you haven't met her. She is smart, wise, kind. Look at the stuff that she's helping to lead. She is a force for good. Really helping to shape and sculpt amazing things that are happening in our industry and all the reasons that all of us are working in and around journalism. She leads a talented team. They work like heck to put this on, and I want to talk about them for a little bit. The ONA staff that Jane leads, Irving Washington, Trevor Noblick, Jess Strelitz, Jen Misgata, Jeremiah Patterson, just fabulous and beautiful. Look at them. They're gorgeous people. They're great. We have an adopted staff as well. Leah Rush, Christine Johnson, Kelly Metz Johnson. These are some of the nicest, hardest working team in journalism, people in journalism. So thank them when you see them. High five them, love them, buy them a free whiskey on the Midway. I'd also like to give a round of applause to our conference co-chairs. The Los Angeles Times' Megan Garvey, ONA board members Robert Hernandez and David Smidra. They were assisted by program chairs Luis Gomez and Julie Westfall. All of our committee members and the nearly 100 volunteers, people who gave their time free freely to help navigate this awesome gathering. So a round of applause for all those folks, please. I want to talk about a couple of things that I'm passionate about before we get to the keynote, but we're really close, I promise. Last year at ONA14 in Chicago, I had the pleasure of leading a panel of very smart lady leaders, we called them. We were talking frankly about their challenges and successes, and the response to that conversation during and afterwards was so overwhelming that we asked the Poynter Institute to join us in creating a comprehensive training program for promising women in digital media. The Women's Leadership Academy in Digital Journalism resulted in the first class of 25 outstanding journalists and leaders who are already changing the industry. You'll meet some of them here today. They're around. Some of them are in sessions. And you'll just get a chance to get inspired by them and the training. I am extremely proud of these women and ONA and Poynter for convening and leading a conversation about women in leadership at a time when it's needed. But wait, there's more. Also joining us here today, all expenses paid, are 33 people representing the next generation of digital media, our 20 college journalists handpicked for the student newsroom. Go and stop by the student newsroom when you have a few minutes. You'll get inspired and brush away any of those thoughts that you have when you worry about journalism. You'll see them and you'll know that the future is bright. We have three 2015 MJ Bear Fellows, all standouts under 30. And we have our second class of digital media fellows from historically black colleges and universities funded by the Knight Foundation. And as a CNNer, I'm extra proud to say our first CNN Diversity Fellows. So you guys, these efforts around diversity and women in leadership are critically important. All of you being here, all of you being members and fans of ONA helps create rich journalism, helps get the right people in the right places, helps get us towards a little bit closer to equality and to equity at a critical time in news organizations and institutions everywhere. So thank you, thank you. And thanks also to our partners and our funders, the people who are giving us their money and time, for understanding the critical importance of quality coverage in underrepresented communities, especially in light of the news events that we've all been covering around this nation and beyond way too many times recently. Okay, thank you. Now, on to the main event. Emily Bell, she is the Tau Center's founding director and one of the sharpest thinkers on digital media. And Richard Gingras, he's the head of news at Google. They should come on up. They are going to give us a deep dive look. They're going to have a candid conversation about the intersection, the collaboration, the competition, all of it between high tech and media. Welcome, Emily and Richard.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed, Meredith. Good morning. I got in at 1 a.m. This morning after teaching two classes yesterday. So I will be throwing to you guys for questions in about 5 minutes. But before I do that, I'd like to welcome our keynote discussant. They described it as a fireside chat, which did fill me with a certain amount of alarm, but apparently that's metaphorical. So Richard actually has brought a fire with him, which he will show you in a minute. But Richard has, I'm always pleased about this as someone who's just reached their 50th year, that Richard has actually been working in media and technology for even longer than I have. Starting out in television in the 70s, we know him perhaps as head of news and partnerships at Google. I knew him first really as the founder of Salon, which was probably the first attempt at serious digital first journalism. But before that, you know, he's been in the television industry, he's done startups, he's been involved in audio, he's been involved in text, he's worked for Hearst, he worked for Apple in the 90s, which is something, again, you know, kind of that he has a really unique perspective on that intersection between journalism and technology. And he's also a passionate advocate of free speech and journalism and how to make it better. Is that flattering enough at this point, Richard? Do you feel?
Makes me feel like I should be on life support.
That can be arranged. The last time I was up here doing one of these at this conference, it was Dick Costolo, so I hope that makes you feel even more confident that this is going to go very well. But given, I mean, Richard, given really your unique perspective, we're going to talk about all the stuff that you're doing at Google, because to me, this feels like a really transformational year in that relationship between technology and journalism. But how do you see that relationship right now? How would you characterize it?
Well, I think, but first off, as you pointed out, when they set this up, the invitation was for an intimate fireside chat. They got the intimate part right, no question. But as some of you know, I have a rather curious obsession in building fires, and the lack of a fire disappointed me, so I figured I'd at least bring that. And maybe that can serve as our inspirational, the ignition of our thinking here for the next hour. But to your point, and I don't want to unduly distract the conversation. But to your point, I think what I've seen over that 40 plus years is going from a point where technology was an enabling mechanism to media, whether that was a printing press or a satellite, to a point where it is literally interwoven with what we do as journalists and as technologists. I think that's so crucial, and I think many here understand that, how absolutely necessary it is that news organizations today be equally as good with the technology as they are with the skills of reporting and writing. It's inescapable to me. For various reasons, but one, because the tools allow journalists to do new and different things, mm-hmm. and secondly, because the ecosystem is going to continue to change. Mm-hmm. All right, it's not going to reach a point of stasis. In fact, the rapidity of change is going to increase, not decrease. The whole circumstance reminds me of an old wonderful line from Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf, where Martha, the strong Martha, says to George, she says, "You know why I love you, George? I love you because you can play the game as fast as I can change the rules." Right? And in a sense, that's what's going on in the ecosystem today, is it's changing so fast that you have to be up to speed with the technology. That being said, I think there are also valid questions as to how do we make sure that those technology efforts are in the interest of furthering the craft and furthering the quality of the product,
right?
And optimizing for the necessary scale, because not every news organization can afford to have 100 engineers, more have 3 or 4.
Well, this brings us to kind of Google's efforts this year, where really sort of from the beginning of the year, maybe even slightly before, we've seen Google do something which I think is unusual. Tell me if I'm wrong about this, which is it said we are part of the news ecosystem. We've done the thing that says, hey, we're just a platform, we're just a search engine, you know, kind of we're not really active in this. And you've gone to being a very active ingredient. You've launched the digital news initiative, we'll come on to an initiative that you may or may not be doing with Twitter, which was written about last week. You made donations to the Charlie Hebdo organization in Paris after the shootings there as an act of supporting free speech. Tell us about that journey within Google or Alphabet, and let us know, you know, kind of what, as it were, what you think being an active ingredient rather than a platform or a search engine really means for Google.
Well, I mean, in a sense, I think it's our own realization of what I just said, that these things are intertwined. It is also, I think, incorporated in the realization that we share a common objective with the ecosystem of publishing and journalism. And that is simply this. Our main product, Google Search, is all about the opportunity to find content in the rich, open ecosystem that is the web, right? We want to enable a rich, open ecosystem that is the web, and it's what makes search valuable. The objective for publishers in this ecosystem is to use it to build new audiences, to engage with new users, to build sustainable business models. That, too, requires an open ecosystem to make work, right? The ability to easily access via open distribution models to get to new audiences and build those sustainable business models. So that's it at the core. I think in addition, there's the realization that we can always do better and always do more. And across the board, particularly in areas where we can do enabling things with technology, help improve approaches to scale in the ecosystem, and provide, in some cases, you know, very targeted tools to help out, whether it's what we do with helping with data analysis, or what the interesting things that Google Ideas has done with Project Shield to help protect against DOS attacks, or to help with individual journalist security. We feel we have to be a good contributing member of the ecosystem as well to properly satisfy our common interests in that ecosystem.
Right, and so let's talk a bit about Google News Labs, which is probably one of the kind of the most, as it were, sort of interesting and active parts of that. Tell us about some of the things that you're supporting through that, or what are your hopes for it? Because a question, you know, being a journalist, I thought the best thing to do was to ask the internet what it thought I should ask you. And people are very interested in that relationship between, say, Google News Labs and Google News, because Google News is almost like, I wouldn't say it's a forgotten product, but it was the thing that we all really thought about a lot in about 2003. And now it's something that we don't perhaps think about as much as we used to. So tell us about Google News Labs and also about that main product, Google News, and how you see the development in one area mapping onto what your plans for Google News are.
So, I mean, Google News Lab specifically is is an initiative simply to take the various things that we're doing in tools and so on, to bring that to newsrooms and simply make sure that everyone has the right opportunity to take advantage of those capabilities. You know, Google News, along with our other canvases, Google Search and so on, and Google News is still, I mean, the numbers are vast. Across the board, we send well over 10 billion visits to news organizations each month. That's all of our Google canvases. So they're obviously a key component in the ecosystem. I mean, our objectives there with Google News and beyond is to continue to address our core mission, which is how can we, on any story, on any query, bring to the surface the best possible expressions of journalism that we can find. And not just a singular article, but with Google News particularly, a diverse set of articles along the range of expression about that story, including making sure from time to time that if it's a story of international import, that we bring in a publication from that geographical area. So those are our objectives: is to bring the best quality content, to provide a diverse set of options in terms of expression, and continue to get that better. It's an unfinished effort. It will always be an unfinished effort. And as you know, there are some other things that we have been working on and stimulating, like the Trust Project, which I imagine we'll talk about at some point, which are frankly designed to help address. Right. Some of those ongoing challenges of how do we do the right thing? How do we give credit where credit is due?
So this kind of like, this idea of how do you do journalism better? Let's talk about the Trust Project. So that was something that started 18 months ago or so, which was this idea where Google said, you know, how can we make journalism better? How can we make trustworthy journalism, you know, trustworthy journalism something which is easier to find? Trust is always I've always found it quite a slippery metric in trust. I spent 20 years working at The Guardian. I was always amused by which media brands in the UK most trusted among the newspapers, and it was always us, and we're, you know, very kind of associated with the left, and the Daily Mail, who are very associated with the right. I think it's fair to say that we didn't trust each other. So this idea of trust can mean something that you think is right. Are we actually just talking more about sort of perhaps simpler things like verification or attribution. Or
no, let me go into that a bit. And to be clear, you know, the Trust Project, yes, I had a key hand with Sally Lehrman at the Markulis Center for Ethics at Santa Clara, who is leading the effort in instigating what we think of as a conversation, as a movement within the journalism community to rethink, in a sense, the architecture of journalism to make sure that the signals are there such that the high quality journalism can be understood and regarded for that, right? The objective isn't about how do we improve the quality of journalism, it's about how do we make sure that the quality journalism that's there is understood to be just that. And to give you just the briefest explanations, it comes out of a very simple analysis that obviously today's ecosystem is vastly different than the one 40 years ago, you know, where the number of publications in the US may have been not more than 10,000, and here we are in the world of the internet where we count them in millions, where, you know, the New York Times is competing on equal footing with blogs and corporate spin sites and so on and so forth. And to us, this simply suggests that we can't rely on the old model of, in a sense, trust us because we're us. Trust us because we're the New York Times or La Stampa. Not that they shouldn't be trusted, but it's just not clear to us that within that ecosystem, that's an easy thing to do. I'll give you, I think I can tell it best with a simple story. I last September was in New York, and at the end of the day, met with a brilliant young journalist who's become a friend, a fellow named Adam Ellick at the New York Times. Right. A lot of you know him. He's the one who did the original documentary on Malala Yousafzai, right? This is a guy who is a one-man band reporter, video, audio, text, doing work in the most dangerous parts of the world. Just tremendous talent. I asked him, I said, what are you working on? And he said, I just finished a three-month project on ISIS. And it's been an editorial review for 3 weeks, various editors, lawyers looking at it, and it's going to be published tomorrow, and I'm glad to get it out. He says, but I know that within hours there are going to be 500 derivative works, you know, done by many folks whose efforts didn't stray beyond their mouse pad, and may have actually interpreted what I said in incorrect ways. And I said to him, I says, well, I understand that fully, and you're absolutely correct, but interestingly, the things that you just told me, you know, about where you've been and how many interviews you've done and how many editors went through it, are things that you know and I know, but the world doesn't know. Your audience doesn't know. Certainly not the audience that's not familiar with the New York Times. And so might it be useful for us to consider, and this is one of the core questions at the heart of the Trust Project, is to consider, might we not take a new approach to surfacing additional signals to the readers and to the algorithms in the ecosystem about the fact that these processes take place? I mean, here we are in a social world where we're all willing to take the social recommendation of a friend to read an article, but the professional endorsements of editors with reputations who are supporting that article are invisible to the world, right? And might we not address that? So that's the nature of the Trust Project, is can we surface additional signals which are now behind the firewalls? In these cases, we're not even asking, to do things that aren't being done, is take the things that are being done and make them more visible. And the great thing is this has resonated throughout the world. You know, so organizations ranging from Die Zeit to The Guardian to The New York Times to Mother Jones to The Guardian to La Stampa, Mario Calabresi, the brilliant editor-in-chief of La Stampa, really helping moving the ball to figuring out what can the new answers be here in the interest of a better ecosystem where the credibility of work has a greater opportunity to be understood. And it's up to the community of journalists to come up with the answers here. Certainly not Google. You know, all I did based on my background with someone like Sally was help get it off the ground. And yes, Google threw in some money to help get it off the ground, as did Craig Newmark. Great thing. But that's the nature of the Trust Project. We think it's very exciting.
And the inevitable cynical question that you get from journalists who, frankly, are very difficult to please, is always, why should we trust you? You know, and this is I guess this goes to a much bigger question, which is not really just about Google, but I'm anxious to hear your thoughts on. One of the things that troubles me, or that I think about a lot, is I see this amazing kind of innovation and great things coming out of platform technology companies every day, like way in advance of anything that we could manage in individual news organizations. And yet the core purpose of Google is not to be a journalism organization. The core purpose of Facebook is not to be a journalism organization. And there are certain things that are expensive and difficult to do, which being a journalism organization really entails. You know, it means not going into territories that will suppress your journalism. It means not censoring. It means being really clear about the editorial decisions you're making and the costs attached to them. It means paying to protect journalists. Google, you know, doesn't do a lot of that. There are lots of the risks of publishing which are not picked up by platform companies. So why should you be the trustworthy guardians of this project when you're also involved in sort of lots of systems where we should be holding that power to account?
Well, 2 points. I mean, first of all, to be clear, we are not the guardians of the project. Get it off the ground. It's yours. It is truly yours. We put money into it. Many others can put money into it as well. It may come to nothing. That's, again, up to the journalism community and the erstwhile efforts of Sally Lehrman. I'll do our part to help. If those signals are there, we'll take and try to use those signals to do a better job in what we do. How do you trust us? I mean, the interesting thing about Google is people can make decisions about whether or not to trust Google every day with a click of their mouse, right? And our work is shown. You know, I've only had one publisher in all my experience come to me and actually say, thank you for the traffic. The only thing is, usually it's, how come we're not getting more traffic? And I understand that completely. It's impossible to satisfy.
I hope that was me. I was always really grateful for Google's traffic. I maybe didn't express it properly at the time.
I don't mean they're underappreciative, but, you know, it's that's fair game. Yeah. But the truth is our work is there for people to see. Our work is there for people to analyze and tell us where we got it wrong. And it's our job to respond to that. And ultimately, our business exists only to the extent that we have the trust of our users for what we do across our Google properties.
Right. One of the things that's interesting, I don't really want to dwell on this, but it would be wrong of me not to raise it, as I am technically a journalist. You know, I think that there's been a sea change in how news organizations think about their partnerships. And I think that's happened in a relatively short space of time. There are one or two kind of significant holdouts in that. News Corporation, which has invested a great deal of money in journalism over the years. Robert Thompson made a speech in Australia last month, where he was, extremely critical of Google and Facebook and LinkedIn, which he called Spam Central, saying that you were basically kind of profiting from the distributionist economy, and the ecosystems that were built here were essentially hostile to investment in reporters and reporting. Now, you know, obviously News Corp has a it has a vested interest in pushing the envelope. But how do you care whether or not you get people like Robert Thompson into the great big Google zeitgeist tent or not?
Of course we do. And obviously there have been several examples of that. I mean that speech in Australia and we've seen others like it was a powerful piece of political diatribe, as it were. I would say that when I look at those, if that were a reporter and I were the editor in chief, I might have some questions about the fact base of it. But so be it. That's political expression, not journalistic expression. I have great regard for News Corp. I have great regard for publishers in the world who, on the one hand, are doing great things in the ecosystem, and on the other hand, challenge Google from time to time. Fair game. Right? We should be able to deal with that and address that. Obviously, on core facts, we disagree. You know, just the basic, I mean, we've been around the internet now 15 years, 20 years, and I look at the internet, and the whole question of the role of aggregators, for instance, in the ecosystem or search engine in the ecosystems, that should be a continued topic of discussion is fascinating to me because there's just so much research, not by us, that shows the economic value of that. Right. I'll shift to the situation in Spain, which you're well aware of. Right. They passed an ancillary copyright law there, basically a link tax that required publishers to get a fee from Google to have their headlines and snippets surfaced. And we said, this breaks the internet. This breaks the very fabric of the link economy of the web. And so we can't do that. We're going to shut down Google News. Painful decision. But we look now at what happened since then, and we said, this is what we forecast will happen. And we look at all the economic analysis and in the studies of the studies, and what has been clear is simply this. Since that law was passed, overall traffic to news organizations in Spain has gone down at a time when internet traffic overall has gone up. And when you look at the damage to individual publications, it's disproportionately large to the size of the organization. Small publishers getting hurt far more than large publishers. And this is obviously, this is crucial. This is the, you know, what we want here is an open ecosystem where large publishers and small publishers can participate easily and build audiences. It doesn't work with those kinds of, you know, link tax laws in place.
So you've used the open word a number of times, and let's talk about Google and publishers in the broader competitive landscape and context. I mean, I've seen several people recently who have been founders of very successful social media companies, who have been journalists and developers, all of whom have a real fear that what's happening with the mobile web is that we are seeing the end of the open web. How do you view that, particularly when we look at what Apple is doing and what Facebook are doing, and talk a little bit about how you see that as a competitive relationship?
Absolutely. And some of you may have read bits and pieces about this subject. We will have more to announce shortly. But let me talk about what's going on there. I think the first thing that we all have to recognize is that the mobile web is in crisis. Can't say it with any less emphasis. Right? And we all know this. You look at your smartphone and we can experience this. The mobile web is slow, pages load jankily. I try to read and something gets moved up or down because of how things are loading. All too frequently there's an annoying ad which pops into place. Not good. Not good in an environment that is crucial to that need to build audiences, build sustainable models of advertising and or subscription content to make news publications viable, right? It's a deep, deep concern, and I think we all share that. So over the last several months, yes, we have been in discussions, in collaborative discussions with publishers around the world, with technologists around the world to see how we can address this issue. And we think the issue, that the solution is in the creation of an open source model that can address this at scale to assure that any publisher's work can be seen at very high speed anywhere and everywhere. All right. This involves some technical architectural changes to how we manage the open web in the interest of accomplishing that. Such that publishers can do this at better scale, such that we can create experiences which are powerful and elegant and sustainable. As we know, there are some serious trends going on out there because of this problem. Right? All too frequently, we're seeing more traffic going to quick views and reader views that strip the business model entirely away. Right? This is obviously not a good thing for this ecosystem. So our whole approach here is how can we address that? How can we make the mobile web fast again? How can we do this such that publishers of any type, any stripe, any size, from large to small, have the opportunity to get their expression out there in an instantaneous way in front of users, following the basic principles of the web we've always had, mm-hmm. right? Where expression is available open and everywhere without requiring a business deal with one platform or another to attain that.
So short of actually buying Apple and maybe Facebook as well, so one question would be, for instance, you know, when will we be able to find Facebook instant articles on Google News?
Frankly, again, it's all about openness, and what we're talking about with this initiative, I think, may be a key element in addressing that, because again, it's how do we do this in an open source framework such that this can happen, such that content can be created once and surface anywhere.
So the slightly sort of facile, reductivist view taken by journalists, who are terrible, has been that this is sort of, you've been mentioned in alliance with Twitter, and it's been characterized as a competitor to Facebook instant articles. In other words, it's allowing things to load very, very quickly, but also returning traffic to publishers' websites rather than requiring them to publish into another app. So could you, are there any more specifics that you're, because it hasn't actually been announced, has it? It's been talked about.
No, it hasn't been announced, and that gave me a little bit of heartburn when the leak occurred. It will be announced soon. And again, I mean, to your point, I don't look at it as competitive with anything, because what we're trying to do really is address this at the foundation of the web, following the principles of the web, you know, such that it cuts across everything, every platform, every publisher. I can tell you, it's been a powerful experience and a unique one for Google in this several month collaboration with so many individuals in the industry. And it's just that, it's a collaboration, because it requires the participation of all, requires addressing all of the issues with the technical framework. It also, frankly, requires that we, as an industry, publishers and the advertising community, relook at the notion of what are acceptable ad standards.
Right.
Right. Because, frankly, that has to be addressed as well, or are we going to lose that crucial sustainable component that's so necessary for the work that everyone here does?
So on ad blockers, what do you think is the solution on this?
Ad blockers, to me, are a symptom of the problem. They're a symptom of the fact that the experiences on these sites have become, in some cases, not all, obviously, but in some cases are so egregious that people can't stand them and invoke other tools. So clearly, it deserves a response. And there's no singular technical solution to that response. The response, like many things, is how do we regain people's trusts? How do we rebuild in them the understanding that, yeah, we'll approach advertising in a different way. We'll come up with more reasonable, acceptable ad standards and hopefully convince users how important it is that model be there, such that all this content which is otherwise available for free can continue to be so.
So we were talking just before we came on stage about the announcement 2 days ago that the Washington Post is going to put all of its articles every day, 1,200 articles, straight into Facebook Instance, going all in with that. You're the editor, Richard. You put yourself in the position of being, you know, an editor of a major U.S. news brand. Is the Washington Post doing the right thing? What would you do given, you know, the opportunity to publish into Instant articles, the opportunity to partner with you guys, the opportunity to work with Snapchat? How are they doing the right thing? Would you do that?
Well,
what's the right strategy?
You know, as some of you know, I mean, I've been talking about the nature of this ecosystem and its focus on the atomic unit of content being the article for years. And that, yes, your objective is to get people to come to your site, come to your app, but the marketing and discovery funnel in this ecosystem are all the other platforms, whether they be Google Search or social networks or messaging apps, all of them. And so for me as a publisher looking at it, it was always, I need to embrace all of these. I need to embrace all of these. Why not? Because I need to use these to build audiences. I think to us, the question is can we, as that evolve, come up with approaches that simplify that to some degree? And again, we have no criticism of anyone who wants to do a specific deal with a platform. We just want to make sure that, again, every publisher, no matter how big, how small, can at the very least have fast access to their content without the need for a business relationship with a specific platform.
So it's about distribution of those tools rather than creating schemes which have access points to them.
Precisely.
But you think the Post was right to go with?
Absolutely, the Post is right. I mean, look at it, and we see this in the numbers. It's been fascinating over the years. You know, we used to cite the rule of thumb that 10 years ago, that my news site, that 75% of the inbound traffic came to the homepage. Mm-hmm. You know, and then 5 years ago, it was 50% of the traffic came to the homepage, and now it's down to 20% coming to the homepage. Now, that, by the way, isn't a bad thing as a percentage of the share of overall audience, right? As long as your number of loyal users is going up, it doesn't matter the percentage. In fact, I remember some folks, when I would say that, I would say, your objective is actually to drive that number down as a percentage, because if you're driving that number down as a percentage, you're doing a much better job of taking advantage of the discovery funnels of other platforms and search engines. So it's obviously continued in that direction. But I absolutely feel that any publisher needs to use any and all means to build audiences.
Do you also say, so this brings us to this issue of distribution versus destination. And I've heard it suggested by people inside large Silicon Valley companies, not necessarily yours, who have said about news industry, I just don't understand it. Why employ 20 developers in your newsroom when we have 20,000? Why have an ad sales team of 50 devoted to getting this tiny amount of revenue when actually we can get billions with the same number? Just focus on the story. Get rid of all that. You know, why are you investing in this separate infrastructure? Why don't you just accept that technology companies will always be able to do that better, and that the things that you do really well are reporting? You know, so, you know, what about that question which says, outsource all of this?
I think that discounts the value of a news organization in and of itself. You know, that its overall value is greater than the sum of its parts. It's not just about an individual journalist. It's about that collection of journalists. It's about the editors that work with them. It's about the definition of their brand and mission. And how can they build engagement against it? I think that's absolutely necessary. You know, it's absolutely necessary to, yes, you want those articles out there. You know, what I always used to say was, you have to think of that individual article. You know, we used to think of the homepage of the website as the door to the publication, when in truth, everyone's coming through the side door, the bathroom window, and so on through the article page, right? And so put the focus on the article page to make sure that's your best representation of who you are as a brand, to try to get you to people to engage more deeply. Mm-hmm. By the way, I'm challenged sometimes when I do that, and I read an excellent article on an excellent publication, and the next thing I see is a headline for, you know, five ways to make money fast in the Los Angeles real estate market or whatever, that has nothing to do with the brand. I'm not sure that's the right path to building brand engagement. So that's absolutely crucial. And in fact, one of my favorite examples in this regard of the importance of understanding who you're about, what your brand is about, and focusing hard on that, is Mediapart in Paris, Edwy Plenel's organization. Right? They focus solely on investigative journalism. It is a hard paywall product, €10 a month. They are profitable, employing 35 investigative journalists. Right? That, to me, proves the point that the right focus, the right brand definition, you can succeed in this environment. But it requires just that. And in general, I think I've seen with many publications, particularly many who've been around a long time, is sometimes failing to recognize that they need to either spawn new products or redefine their product, because their product definition was based in a prior era.
Let's talk about a sector of the market, though, that's of, I think, particular interest to this audience, and which I think hasn't been served well by the mechanics of the open web, and that's the local market. So the local market has effectively, for news, been destroyed by the open web, and we haven't come up with a solution yet. And that's not the fault of the journalists and the strategists and the managers and the investors, because there's been a ton of innovation in that sector, and it's desperately needed. What is the solution there when you simply can't make the scale work at a local or hyper-local level?
I mean, again, I do not reach the conclusion that one can't make it work. We see example. I look and see what, for instance, folks like Voices of San Diego are doing, and many others like that. But there too, I think it requires a very crisp definition or redefinition of what you're about, and make sure that that's the pure focus of what you do. I mean, interestingly, if you look at the newspaper market, right, The newspapers that continue with degrees of health are the very local newspapers. I don't mean the metropolitan newspapers, I mean the very local newspapers. Because they're providing something that no one else does that people are willing to pay for. So I don't by any means feel that there aren't great opportunities there. But it does require that, you know, a very different way of thinking and a very sharp focus on what you're trying to accomplish in a given market.
Is Google thinking about doing more in particularly that sector of the market?
Yes, well, in the sense of are we doing, you know, can we do better and better in terms of our surfacing of local content? Without question, it's one of the primary objectives of our teams right now is to do a better job with how we identify and surface local content.
And what, I mean, one of the things that publishers do say, both local, national, and international, is one of the problems with the relationship with Google is simply access to data. So you guys know way more about a publisher's, you know, advertising profile than the publisher does itself, and this sort of disconnect between data about your product and, you know, the publisher and the ability to monetize that seems to be a critical problem. And you can actually solve that by returning more data to publishers.
Well, you know, as you know, there are a series of interesting questions there. And we all know, and there's not a publisher in this room who isn't seeking to build a better profile about their individual users when they know who their individual users are. Clearly, that's important. And Google would love to figure out ways to provide assistance here. But as you know, I mean, one of the core issues here, which is so important, is privacy, is how do we protect users' data, right? Google does not provide personally identifiable information to third parties. It's absolutely crucial that we protect that. It's absolutely crucial we give our users data controls to make sure that they can turn on or off what we do with information. And in no case do we share it with outside third parties. So the question is are there means of, and I don't know the answer here, are there means to assist in this regard at the same time of protecting the privacy of the user?
Or you could just give us the data. Anyway, that's a...
And I can imagine...
You could just, you and Facebook and Apple,
yes.
Could just give us the data.
And I can read the follow-on articles.
Really, we would promise not to give it to the NSA.
I was at a major news organization a while ago, and one of their tech journalists was grilling me on the point of data privacy and so on. And one of the other people in the room from that same publication said, you know, by the way, we do that also. You know, it's an interesting challenge.
So I'm just going to ask you one other question to distract you while I get people to put your hands up. I think if we go to Q&A in the audience now, because we've got about 15 minutes left. So I can't see anything. So you're going to have to be my seeing eye guest on this. And if we have a little bit more light in the auditorium, we can actually see where the questions are coming from. But so this is a question about sort of a key competitor and a key product, which is, do you think Apple is actually going to succeed in moving people from the open web to a closed version of the mobile web?
I certainly hope not.
Okay. You certainly hope not. Do you think it is a possibility?
I think there are things going on there which can certainly make it a possibility. But I'll leave that to others to opine about. I mean, I think we've stated I've said a lot about our thinking about how we think the open web, the mobile web should evolve, and open model, open source frameworks, I should say, that can help make that work in a better way. Okay. And if we do that right, then I don't think that will be the end result.
Okay, right, questions. Do we have roving microphones, I think? I really can't see anything. So anyone with a question, raise your hands. And anyone with a microphone, you can go to questions. Here we go, there's one down the front.
The first anonymous questioner.
Yes, exactly. Sorry, you're going to have to shout. I will relay. We have a question down here. If we can get a microphone down here, it's coming. Oh, sorry, this is just right here. Thank you. Sorry, and could you just say who you are when you ask a question.
Sure. I'm James Koo with the Reno Gazette Journal. So the question is, as we develop content specifically for mobile that differs from desktop, how will Google be able to help us surface that content for readers to discover?
Great question.
First of all, it need not be crafted different from desktop, right? And as we've worked on the framework, we're trying to be very, very cautious that in doing this, that it be easy for publishers to adopt and scale. That, for instance, that the various CMS systems out there can help in accomplishing that. Because one core objective of what we set out to do was a very specific one, was how do we create a framework that allows the precious engineering resources of a publisher to do what you do and not get so bound down in creating bespoke implementations of content for platform after platform after platform.
Does that answer your question? To some. Okay, good. I think there's a question back there. And also, if you have questions in the wings, wave your arms around and shout at a certain point, because I don't want my limited vision to limit your ability to ask a question. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm Alex Remington. I'm a product manager with the Washington Post. The history, at least in America, of both newspapers and of technology companies frequently seems to be one of consolidation. Certainly, the great newspaper companies that consolidated in the 60s and 70s seems to mirror to some degree the habit over the last 10 years of the largest technology companies to purchase other technology companies. Do you see that consolidation as continuing to be a feature of the news landscape? And if so, does that harm actual provision of news?
Great question. And they have consolidated a bit themselves, mm-hmm. The Washington Post.
I think it depends on the technology platform. I think every folks in the room have, there had been rumors years ago about whether Google would, for instance, acquire a publishing company. And it wasn't a hard answer. It wasn't a hard question for us to answer. We don't think that's appropriate to our business, particularly given our role in the ecosystem. Our role in the ecosystem is to, again, identify knowledge in the ecosystem and make it available to audiences who want to see that. That's our job. And I would rather not get into a situation where one might presume that those results might be biased based on a property we own. So for us, that's not, to us, an attractive model. I can't speak for others. As the history of journalism is rife, and I mean that in a good way, with companies, with rich organizations, rich families, rich individuals, investing in news organizations, either through a sense of civic pride or through a sense of benevolence, or they want to influence public opinion. Very common. And I won't deride that. It's been a key part. And I obviously what's important is that we have news organizations out there who are independent, doing high quality work. So in principle, I wouldn't disagree with that. I think it is very specific to the kind of company you are as to whether you want to get into that business. And certainly Google, we have a different view.
Can you see Facebook or Apple or Twitter even breaking off one of their billions and really building out a news vertical in a way that makes them indistinguishable from a media company?
I think all things are possible. I wouldn't want to speculate. All things are possible. I think the only thing that will ever concern me is to the extent to any of these kinds of efforts, particularly by platform companies, serve to dilute the diversity and the richness of the underlying ecosystem.
So the waving arms and shouting at the back shall be rewarded with a microphone and a question. If anyone else is waving arms and shouting. Here. God, that was a tiny. There we go, and there's one there. And I think there as well. Sorry, it's all right, the arm wavers are now, you're now the passive aggressive majority in this room, so well done. We'll go there, and then I think there's one down here.
Hi, I'm Nikki Usher at GW.
Hi, Nikki.
Hi, Emily. thank you for this great keynote. I had a question that I wanted to push you on a little bit. And as we know, in terms of patterns of web traffic dynamics, the web small sites stay small, big sites stay big. And there's a lot of talk about openness, but one of the things we know is that Google has a secret algorithm. So how do you sort of justify this talk about openness when we know, you know, the dynamics of web traffic are what they are, and there's no way to avoid them with a secret algorithm?
Yep. Yeah, first of all, I would partially disagree that small sites always don't remain small sites, or that they only have impact within the range of their audience. You know, I look at the fact that we've had now Pulitzers run by small organizations doing powerful work. You know, that's a remarkable thing. We look and see new news organizations that have sprung up from nothing to 100, 200 million uniques in a period of 2 years. So I don't follow that. I understand going from small to large is not easy, but it does happen, and it can only happen with the capabilities of the web, where everyone has that opportunity to do so. About the algorithm. My main point about the algorithm is simply this. Yes, it's a very complex piece of work. It changes all the time. However, the results of that effort are there for everyone to see. The results of that effort are there for everyone to analyze and tell us whether we're getting it right or wrong. So indeed, that's a very, very good way. And I hear from publishers and organizations all the time who do that to help make sure that we get it right. So the algorithm itself, yes, that's not something that we're comfortable disclosing, but we show our work. And our work is easily analyzable by anyone out there to help guide us in the right direction or tell us where we're not doing the right thing. And we encourage folks to do that.
Other question at the back of them. I think there was one down. There's one certainly here, and I think there's one down
there.
Hey there. Here as well.
Justin Myers, Associated Press. I'm wondering about this trend in, you know, Google's effort and Facebook's effort and others really focusing on the article, which reminds me of a struggle that a lot of us developers in newsrooms have already fought internally. Where does this focus on articles leave the photojournalists, the video journalists, the audio journalists, the interactive developers who don't produce articles as the atomic unit of content?
No, I thank you for that. Really thank you for that. I completely agree. I don't mean when I say atomic unit of content to mean just storytelling. I think that's absolutely a crucial point. You know, I'm extremely optimistic about the future of news because of the various capabilities we have. One of them, for instance, is data journalism. All right, I think data journalism is a hugely valuable capability. And in fact, what I have been strongly encouraging folks is to, you know, now every newsroom has data journalists, and typically what that means is they'll do a lot of data analysis and an article would be written and we'll have some graphics and interactive components using that data. Wonderful thing. But I think there's also an opportunity to go beyond that. ProPublica has done this well, to go beyond simply the use of data journalism to support an article, as it were, but the use of data journalism to create an atomic unit, a knowledge utility in and of itself which persists, right, that provides value to the community. So if one is doing analysis about the state of the Los Angeles City schools or the state of dialysis treatment centers, might one look at that with persistence such that I anytime could go to that utility and enter my zip code and understand what's going on in my school system?
Right? I think there are powerful opportunities there, and I think many of them actually have the opportunity to have business models attached, but that too is an atomic unit of content. It's not just about stories, it's about video, it's about audio, it's about imagery, it's about all of the evolutions of storytelling that we should consider. Because the truth is, our audiences are different today. And one thing I've always said is, like, you know, and even when I was running Salon years ago, I was saying, like, we need to rethink the structure and form of our articles. And I'm not going to tell you what it is. I'm just saying experiment. But when I see that most of our audience is out there reading material from phones in quick bits of information, then we might want to rethink how we get that knowledge into their heads, whatever form necessary. So that atomic unit of content is all of those things. And I thank you again for surfacing that.
Okay, we have, I think, a question. There's one in the middle right here, and I think there was one down, right down the front here.
And then I can do some a few minutes.
Yeah.
Hello, Mario Tedeschini Lally, Gruppo L'Espresso in Rome. May I rephrase Emily's question about data? Would you allow publishers of any dimensions to have data, all the anonymous data you have? I mean, you've been phrasing your answer in a privacy setting. Of course, we don't want to know what you may know about me or others in my out of my Gmail account, but we're talking, you know, you may have some very detailed data about interactions of people with my content, which may be useful, more than, of course, we get usually from Google and Analytics.
You know, to be clear, as I've noted, we're engaged in lots of conversations with publishers around the world, and one of those conversations is indeed about data. But I think to do that, and I'm not saying there aren't things that we can do there today, we just have to make sure that we do whatever we do in a highly principled fashion, because I think we all know how deep the concerns are about privacy, how deep the concerns are about experiences that people say are creepy. So we need to do that in a right and principled way. I don't know what the answer is. I like to think that there are answers where we can help, but I don't have the answer specifically today, but we have to make sure they're very principled.
Okay, I'm going to take one last quick question and then hand over to Richard T. Kleiss.
Hello, Aaron Zuckersheriff. I'm a full stack developer for Salon.com. And you mentioned trust signals and how to indicate them to Google and to readers. Google recently supported one trust signal, which was authorship, and then stopped supporting it because bad actors in the media ecosystem were more able to implement it than the publications that we want to support. So what can Google do to support those future trust signals that can help the algorithm and not be implemented by bad actors?
No, it's a very good question. And suffice to say, the authorship initiative didn't work out quite the way we wanted to. Not just for the reasons of spamminess, there are other reasons there. We don't always do things perfectly. I think the Trust Project is a very different and more comprehensive effort, again, on what the industry decides to do there. Any system like that has the potential for spam, right? I mean, we spend so much time dealing with spam vectors, as you could imagine. And there are no perfect solutions. One of the things I have mentioned with regard to the Trust Project, for instance, is I do think that the signals that folks might come up with for the Trust Project should be signals that the publication is comfortable displaying to the user, not just metadata that is displayed only to algorithms, right? I had, for instance, one editor said, you know, maybe there should be a signal about an eyewitness account. You know, maybe that's a good idea. And I don't know whether it's a good idea or not, but what I did say is that could only work to the extent that that label, eyewitness account, was there for every reader to see and every other journalist to see who's working that same story to make sure that we all have some sense of accountability. So yes, that is a significant challenge in any of these things. But my general view in the work of algorithms is that the more signals we have, the better. Always issues of dealing with the veracity of the signals, but more is better than less, particularly as we try to do, as I say, give credibility where credibility is due.
Great. So we're nearly up to time, but Richard, over to you to kind of, it's been, a, so actually, just before I let you sum up, I just want to say thank you, which is earnestly and well-meant, because this is a really important conversation. It is so hard to get anybody from a technology company to come and have the kind of open conversation we've had. And we may not have got the answers we like, but thank you for actually kind of putting yourself in front of journalists who, it has to be said, are awful with your probing questions. I just wanted you to close and sum up with, I know you have some things to say.
No, I thank you, and it's a really a delightful experience. You know, as was noted, I've been in and around the news business for over 40 years. I can barely count that high. One of the things I've noticed about the journalism community over those years is it's one of the few professions where people are so driven by passion, right? And that's such a powerful, powerful thing. It's what drives me as well. These have been poignant times for me, just to be personal and honest about it. My dad passed away recently at 94. He kept the presses running at the Providence Journal. I worked there as a flyboy. That's what ignited my own passionate interest in publishing platforms, be it printing presses or broadcast or satellite or the internet, on to this day. My father-in-law went to jail in pursuit of the principle that the government has no right to ask you about your political beliefs, free expression at its purest, which also drives me. I don't say that to make me unique, I'm not. I suspect everyone in this room has similar experiences, similar individuals that drive you to do what you do. And that's a powerful thing. So what do we do with that? As I said, I'm hugely optimistic about the future of news. But it's all about potential, it's all about opportunity. And it's going to take the collective efforts of everyone here to explore all of these questions and options and opportunities. What is the nature of the evolving form of the article? You know, I love to see what folks like Melissa Bell and Ezra Klein are doing with Fox, as you said, with Edwy Plenel in Paris, with Mediapart, and so many others. How do we take full advantage of the opportunities in data journalism to do knowledge utilities? How do we grapple with the questions of trust? I mean, the internet is an extraordinary thing, but the internet, as we know, you know, it has value, but it doesn't have values. It is as capable of amplifying any fear, any disbelief, any unfactual bit of information as it is the reverse, right? And we have to figure out ways to address that, which to me is why efforts like Sally Lehrman's Trust Project are so crucial. How important it is to grapple with the questions of how do we maintain a rich and vital mobile web such that every publisher, no matter what size, has a good opportunity to participate in the conversation and build their audiences. These are all hard questions. And they're questions that aren't going to be solved by a single company or a few big companies or a single individual or a few individuals. It's only going to be solved through the collective creative efforts of everyone in this industry, of everyone in this room. And so the only thing I ask is that everyone, no matter what position you're in, no matter what level you're in, is to challenge the thinking, look to be creative, look to try things and be comfortable making mistakes, because it's the only way we will get there. And so I thank you for that. I thank you for the time today. And I look forward to continuing to engage on this. You know, it's such a fascinating period. And obviously, I'm more at the tail end of my career than the early part of my career. So it is very, very much in the hands of people here to figure this out. And I wish you all the best in doing it.
Thank you very much indeed, Richard, and thank you very much indeed to audience for your better questions than mine. It was a delightful experience to interview you. I've never had an interview by me described as delightful before, so that's a first as well. Thanks very much indeed, everybody.